Good morning, everyone, and it's fantastic to be with you all this morning. Let's just bow and begin with a word of prayer. Dear Father God, we thank you for your word. And as we open it today, God, we look for inspiration, we look for encouragement, and we look to honor you with this time that we spend as a community from social isolation. In your name we pray, amen. I wanted to begin this morning by showing you guys a little cartoon that I've come across over these last couple weeks. As you can see, it's a fictitious image of God and Satan having a conversation about what's going on in the eternal struggle between good and evil. Satan is relishing his victory, thinking that he has accomplished something by closing the buildings we use, and God reminding him that Christianity is so much more than the buildings that we have. I think there's a great wisdom in this comic that can teach us something unique. The fact that as leaders, we need to accept what we don't have control over, but we also look at the potential of what is in existence and what God is building. This actually historically puts us in the same position if we look back as the New Testament church. The New Testament church was a home church, a community that gathered together in and amongst what they had to celebrate what the Lord had been doing. If anything, as Christianity, we have lost a little bit of something in terms of only the material possessions that we have, and not the potential and the impact that God can have in this time. As a little bit of an update, our elders and our board have been in constant contact through Zoom meetings, through phone calls, discussing of what is going to happen as we move forward. And the reality is that we're not entirely certain of what the future holds, but we know at least for the time being, for the next number of Sundays, and as long as there's a state of emergency within the province of Ontario, we will not have the opportunity to meet and gather together. Now, acknowledging this, saying this, it is not promoting fear. Accepting the reality of what we face is not a lack of faith and not a disagreement with the fact that God can do amazing, wonderful miracles. It's acknowledging the situation we're in and using wisdom that God has given us to discern how to navigate this season that we're in. So what does a shift of Christianity look like in the year 2020 when the opportunity to gather together in large numbers is no longer there? What does this mean for the movement of the church? How do we continue to do ministry? Well, from everything I've read in Scripture, from everything I understand, the mission of the church has not changed, it has not been affected, and it has not led us to a dead end. God is building and making something here. Now, earlier this month, I had the opportunity to submit an assignment for school. It was a 60-page philosophy of ministry. A philosophy of ministry is basically an outline of, as a Christian leader, what do you believe to be the core values of how you do your ministry? If you were to sum it up in a sentence or a framework, what would you believe are those most important scriptural points that inform how we minister together? And how long did it take me to come up with that one point? 60-odd pages from Romans chapter 1, verse 5. Through him we have received grace and apostleship to call all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith for his name's sake. When we look at this passage, there are actually quite a few amazing things that stand out for us. And the first is that we have received grace, that God has given something to humanity, to his creation. He's given us something that we haven't earned, that we didn't ask for, that we weren't even aware that we needed. A freedom to be healed of the ways in which we hurt ourselves and hurt others and pull away from God. God gave us this grace so that we would know who he is, that having been made in his image, being made unique, that we have the ability to actually enter into a relationship with the Creator himself. That by giving this grace, God showed us his immeasurable, infinite power, and that this grace leads us to be changed ourselves, to be no longer slaves to the bad attitudes we have, the struggles that we endure, and the negativity that sometimes feels so overwhelming. The reality is that in receiving this grace, we have received this title and mantle of apostleship. Now, apostleship in Scripture is most often referenced to the 12 disciples themselves. Some of the writers in the New Testament use that term interchangeably, the apostles, the disciples, describing these people who had given their lives to seeking and following the teachings of Jesus. Even in through the book of Acts, as Judas was replaced by Matthias through a collective agreement, he was chosen as an apostle for the church. And as we move farther in the book of Acts, we actually see a more broadening of this term of apostle. It started to be used to describe more individuals than just those who directly knew Jesus. Even Matthias being given one of these roles was a way in which authority and empowerment was laid on him. And through the New Testament, this term becomes so general that it's applied to each and every one of us. And that this title of apostle, this role of being imbued with the need to share the truth and revelation of Jesus, is something that each and every one of us experience today. That simply by declaring that Jesus is alive, simply leading in a way that we speak the truth of who he is, we ourselves are apostles. And that this role comes to us through the grace that God has given. Now, this role has certain things that need to be accomplished. When we look at the Great Commandment, the Great Commission, we see very clearly that there's a specific attitude and response and goals to accomplish if we are to live this role of apostle. In Romans 1, verse 5, it specifically starts taking a look at this concept of sharing with the Gentiles this truth. Which we know historically Gentiles were those who had not yet received the blessing of the truth that God had given. They may have been farmers, they may have been individuals from other religions, but they were all in that same position of in need of a greater intimacy with God. And this message is so unique for the Church of Rome because what they had gone through over the last 25 years before Paul wrote the letter to the Romans. Due to a decree that Caesar had made, it required all Jews to leave Rome. And for this church that was planted by Jewish individuals, whose leadership was Jewish in nature, the church lost their entire core founders of their organization. The people who had set it on its feet, the people who had made the first converts. And very quickly, this church found themselves without any of the individuals that they held in their tightest needs. They found themselves without their core leaders, without their foundational members, but the church still needed to move on and to grow and to continue that mission that God had given them. And it did so entirely on the efforts, energies, and investments of those Gentile converts. Now, some years later and a few years before Paul wrote the letter of Romans, Jews were permitted to re-enter, but the Jews who came back to this church came back to a totally different church. They came back to a ministry that had grown and flourished during their absence. And at the same time, they began to see the legacy of what it looks like to build something with other believers. So as this call has gone out for apostleship to these Gentile converts, people who are brand new in their faith, it's encouraging and calling them not only to reach those who have not received the blessing of salvation through Christ, but it's calling them to lead and disciple those in their own community who are earlier in their faith. You and I both know that Christianity is not a finish line endeavor. We celebrate when individuals cross the finish line and receive Jesus, but that is truly where the journey begins. So in this call of apostleship, it's not just simply a call to elicit conversions, but it's a call to elicit the continued life-changing experience that an individual can have through a relationship with Jesus Christ. This call has such a greater application than simply those who don't know, but it's more in line with those who need to know more. And this is a principle of leadership that applies to all of us. And that's what it means to be an apostle. To use what the Lord has given you and to share it with those who have less of it than you do. And Paul describes this act of living this apostleship as not a title or a mantle to hold or a simple event to check off in a to-do list. But he calls it as a natural, yearned response to God for what he has done. And he describes it as obedience, that the willingness to call out in the name of Jesus to those who have not heard it is an act of obedience to the grace that God has given us. God saved us, and now we have this opportunity to continue to pass the experience on to other people of just what the Lord does in your life when you give him space. And by reaching out through not only conversions but discipleship, we have the ability to fulfill an act of obedience to God. Because we have been changed, so we see the value that that change can bring in others. For those of us who do find ourselves in a relationship with Jesus Christ, we know that we have been given a gift. We know that we have received that gift, and that gift has changed our lives. We know that God has changed our lives in a way that is powerful, in a way that is real, by giving us access to the Holy Spirit, by allowing us through his strength to be better than we were. And that this should lead us to share that gift, share that truth with others. And why do we do it? We do it for the glory of God. We do it because God deserves a response to the gift that he's given, to the freedom, to the healing that he has given. When you receive a gift, you say thank you, you write a card, you express your gratitude to the person who's given it to you. And we often hear this concept of life debts. When someone saves another person's life, that the two of them are bonded in a way that can't be broken from that point forward. So how deep would the bond be with God who has healed and saved us? Romans chapter 1 verse 5 gives us this explicit instruction that if we follow Jesus, we will be compelled and willing to share what we know to be true with the people in our lives. This obedience is the ability to reach out to those around us who know less about Jesus than we do, believers or people who are still seeking, or people who are still trying to understand that God is real. So when we look at this passage in Romans 1 and 5, when we look at what the goal is of Christianity through the Great Commission and the Great Commandment, and when we realize we're in a season where we are all staying home, where we are not gathering together, where a lot of us are grieving because we feel like church just isn't the same anymore, we have to ask ourselves the question, from a biblical standpoint, from Scripture, has Christianity really changed? Not in the slightest. In fact, God has simplified things for us in this time. We live in a much less demanding time than we used to. And maybe if you've got kids in your household and you're doing school, maybe it's closer than some of the rest of us in terms of how busy things are. But God has removed distractions. God has taken away our opportunities to be too busy to really engage with him. We find ourselves in a position where we have the time and have the opportunities in front of us to do something new. Or maybe we have the opportunity to hear what the Lord has been trying to tell us for some time. But we've just been way too busy and unwilling to hear what God is saying. I believe as we are struggling with the changes that we're going through, I do not believe this is a time of sadness and sorrow. I do not believe this is a time to be overwhelmed by doubt and frustration. I believe it's a time to be encouraged with what we do have, to remind ourselves as Canadians that we have more freedoms than most of the rest of the world in terms of freely declaring the fact that God is real. And I think it's time for us to build something. Something that works for the stage of life that we're in. Something that has an impact to the people that are in our lives. So the question for each of us this morning, and the question that I've been asking myself, and I know the pastors and church leaders and family leaders that I've been speaking to have all been asking ourselves the question, what does it look like to build the church with the cultural reality of where we're at today? And I believe a big part of that has to do with sharing our faith. If this role of apostleship means to share our faith, and if obedience to God's gift is sharing our faith, that needs to be a priority for us in this season that we're in. That needs to be a focus and a desire that burns in our hearts to feel the need that what we have is valuable enough for somebody else to experience it too. And the question becomes, how do we share that from our homes? The first, and one that any of us, regardless of any age, can do, we can pick up a phone and we can make a call. Somebody was asking me, what's it like to be a pastor now that you're stuck from home? And I said, probably a lot what it was like in the 70s and 60s and 80s, where you didn't have the internet to do what we do, so you called people. You spent most of your time getting engaged with people, even in a way, face to face. I think for each and every one of us, we can all pick up a phone and call somebody, not just to have a chit-chat on, oh, what we think the government's going to do next, but to encourage each other, to use it as an opportunity to declare that God is still speaking to us in our life. Or, if we don't feel that we're hearing what God is saying, to even express the fact that I'm spending more time in personal solitude, I'm spending more time trying to listen to God. We can change the entire emotional reality of how we as Christians are dealing with this if we simply work towards encouraging and building each other up, to declaring the great works, the healing that God is doing right now, and to testify to that to the people that we speak with. And to be doing this not just with our own Christian friends, but particularly those who are non-Christian. And I know for many of us, we all struggle with that in different ways, of how to be explicit in terms of what God is and is not doing with somebody who doesn't see the world the same way that we do. But simply by pointing to hope, pointing to the fact that there is good at work in the world right now, that can be the beginning of helping somebody see the way that God is moving. The second thing that we can be doing is in terms of our online services. I'm going to put a graph up for you, and what you're going to see in this graph is really interesting. Before we began doing mobile church, our average Sunday morning views on our YouTube page for a service or sermon were 30 to 60 views. That would be people catching up during the week who saw a video or who missed the service and would catch up on a video service. during any one of our online services since then, there have been anywhere from 50 to 70 people watching that Sunday morning at 10:45. Now, when we say 50 to 70 people, that means 50 to 70 computers. I know in our household there's four. I know many other people, at bare minimum, are two people together watching that church service. So that 50 to 70 is probably closer to 100 to 140, which fits in exactly with how many of us would normally be together on a Sunday morning. But what's happening in this graph, and you can take a look at it now, the average number of views that we're getting on our services since going mobile is now 200 to 250. Now, I asked our elders this past week when we were talking about these statistics, how many of us as elders have watched the service 2-3 times in a week? And nobody raised their hand, and I didn't expect anyone to. So if there are 70 of us, which accounts likely statistically for most of our congregation, watching on a Sunday morning, and that counts as 70 views, that means the other 150 are people watching it during the week, or more likely than that, non-Christians who are seeing these videos shared and who are curious enough because of the relationship they have with us to click on it and see what is this going on. Why is Sarah Choi posting videos of her Sunday service on her Facebook? So statistically, if we look at this again, let's even put in a decent margin of error of, say, 25%. I think out of those 230 views on a Sunday morning, I think we can realistically expect that half of those are non-Christian, non-church people. And I have faith that that is what God is doing right now. He's using this mobile platform to share the truth of his world in ways that we didn't do before. Online has literally become one of our primary opportunities to evangelize right now. And it's as simple, for those of you who have social media, as clicking share. My youth pastor used to always tell us growing up, if you don't have the nerve to tell your friends about Jesus and walk that through, invite them to youth group and I'll do it for you. And I think the same can be said about our online experience, about the moments that we have for the Holy Spirit to work through the technology to give somebody hope in this, what can seem to be sometimes a really dark season. The opportunity to declare Jesus simply through a few keystrokes of the computer. So as we evangelize and as we take this time to really put some effort into sharing our faith, the other thing that we're still in need of working on is deepening relationships with each other. And I think that this time for us to grow as a community is more important than it ever has been. For us to be sitting down with our families, with your spouses, and having dinner together. To shut out all distractions, to make all the meals together family experiences. Because I know there are some couples, empty nesters who have no kids, who are struggling right now because they've never really had to live with their spouse, even though they've lived in the same household, because they've both been so distracted. And they're in the process of rediscovering who the other partner is because they've never been so unbusy to be able to realize what they've been missing. I know we've been having our prayer meetings, which has been fantastic to see those numbers growing. But I know also our small group ministry has not had the opportunity or seen the need to dive back in together. There are some groups who are still meeting, but a large number of them have not. We have the tools available. We have our Zoom meetings, which is an opportunity to gather, and this should be the time where we should still be doing digital dinners with congregation members. If you want to have a chance to catch up with another congregation member via video, send us an email and we can facilitate that one-to-one opportunity, because we need to deepen our relationship with each other. We need to be continuing to study and to grow and work through the scriptural studies that we're doing. I was in a youth conference this past week, a digital one, obviously, and they were talking about how curriculum is as important now as it ever was for structured and measured processes to follow through with to grow in our relationship with God. Because if I'm reading this season that we're in right now with any sense of accuracy, I don't think this social isolation is ending anytime soon. And for us, that might be a painful thing to hear. And I don't say that out of negativity or recognizing that God can't do amazing things. But from what we've seen and using the wisdom that God gave us and being realistic about the future, this may be where we're at for a while, and therefore positivity is more important than it ever has been. And I know many of us, including myself, are counting down the days or weeks until we can get back to what life used to be like, where we can go to a restaurant or run into the hardware store or visit with friends. But I've been starting to wonder if maybe the way in which we lived our faith before this wasn't what God had designed for the church. And that God is trying to speak something new to us in this season. But how much more effective we can be for the kingdom if only we would open ourselves to the new reality that we're in and be more creative and intentional with how we spend our time. Because genuine Christianity is not about public gatherings. It's about receiving and expressing the life-changing experience that you have had through the truth and grace of Jesus Christ. And I know many of us thought this would all blow over in a matter of 2 weeks or a month. But I think when I look at what the New Testament church was like, I think God is calling us back to the roots of how our faith operated in those early days. As we live in community, as we live and experience God's grace from our homes and through our homes. And as the value and freedom now to share our faith is more unrestricted than it ever has been. And I think for all of us, God is just leading us to dream and to be willing to see what we haven't before, to be a part of building something new, and to do that out of obedience to the apostleship that he has given to us. Let's pray. Dear Father God, there's so many different things that we lay at your feet. Hopes, dreams, fears, anxiety. And Lord, having laid it at your feet, we ask for you to give back to us only what it is that would sustain us, only what it is that we need. Lord, embolden us in this time to be willing to talk about you through the venues and opportunities that we have, whether it be through a phone call or by sharing a service online or yelling at our neighbor across the driveway. Lord, allow us to be emissaries of encouragement in this time. To not wallow in pity or anger or grief over what we don't have, but allow us to see the potential of what you have given us. Father, as we come before you today, we ask that you would navigate ahead of us and that we would be wise enough to follow in your steps. In your most holy and precious name we pray.